Hi, everyone. My name is John Bassett. I'm the Chief Information Security Officer with GSI. I want to talk to you about the importance of multi-factor authentication today by giving you a few examples. I can give you a couple from GSI itself, but also something that happened to a friend. So starting with GSI, 3 or 4 months ago, we started looking at our Office 365 logs, and we could see that people were trying to sign in as us from all over the world. We were seeing login attempts from Russia, from North Korea. People were trying to sign in from Ashburn, Virginia, that were nowhere near it. And we started looking at it, and those were failed attempts. The people were just trying over and over and over to break into our accounts. And multi-factor authentication was the answer. They were trying to sign in with single-factor authentication. They were trying multiple accounts. Maybe they got the list from a nefarious site that sells credentials. But either way, the multi-factor authentication was blocking those login attempts, and they were not successful at getting in. It did allow us to change our policies. Fortunately, Office 365 allows you to do conditional access. So the way we set that up was we would look at where each person was located. We have people all over the world, and people from India and Ukraine, wherever they might be, you know, they're authorized to sign in from those locations. So we granted them conditional access, but we did not grant them the authority to sign in from the United States because that's not where they live. We also did that with our US-based resources. If a person lives in the United States and they're there 99% of the time, we restrict their access to only sign in from the United States or close thereabouts. We have people that travel, of course. Therefore, we would allow them to make changes and requests as they go to different countries to accommodate that. Now, for the other really interesting story about multi-factor authentication working, we had a friend who utilized alarm.com for their home security. And while this person was on the road a week or so ago, he got a text message from alarm.com about a security code, but he was driving and had no idea why anybody would be trying to access alarm.com, nor did this person even really think about what he would have on alarm.com that anybody would want. So he actually pulled over and looked at his login attempts from his phone. He had alarm.com on his phone, and he could see that a person was trying to get into alarm.com from Ashburn, Virginia, yet he was located in the Ohio area. It didn't make any sense. And then he started looking at it, and it turns out this person had made a fundamental mistake. The account ID and password that he was using was a very old account, and he had not changed his password. He'd made a sweep of his accounts a few months back and had updated many of them, but this was one that was overlooked because it wasn't in his browser. It was just on his phone, and he didn't uncover it. So he was using credentials that had been hacked a long time ago. But fortunately, alarm.com had required multi-factor authentication to get into it. It blocked it. In addition, the person used his email ID. So he not only changed his password, but he also changed his ID, making it far harder to guess. It's always easier to guess just a password when you already have the ID. So he did two things: changed his ID, changed his password, but multi-factor authentication saved the day. If you have not fully implemented multi-factor authentication, I highly recommend that you do that. It's a top priority for you to protect your accounts, and also try to use a password manager for any web-based programs such as 1Pass or Password Manager, something like that, to make it easier on you. As always, stay safe. Thank you, and goodbye.